Now, I know what you're wondering. Where is my Neo review? A lot of you keep asking me for a review of Neo, and trust me, it is coming. But Neo is a hard game, and honestly, it's taking me a while to get through it. In fact, I've been playing Neo for about 2 years now trying to get through it, but it is challenging, so it will take me a while. I will get it out after my Ghost of Tsushima review, but please be patient with me on that. But anyways, another game I have been meaning to take a look at for some time now is the most recent, as of 2020, entry into the Nobunaga's Ambition series, Nobunaga's Ambition Taishi. Being that this game is a couple of years old already by the time of me making this video, I understand that a lot of you may have already played it, and if that's the case, I would love to hear what your thoughts are about it in the comments. Previously, I made a review of Nobunaga's Ambition Sphere of Influence, a game that I gave a solid 10 out of 10. If you haven't played that game or seen my review of it, please go check it out, because a lot of this video will be referencing stuff from that game, as it is the most popular and critically successful of the more recent Nobunaga's Ambition titles. But let's take a look and see if Taishi can stack up to Sphere of Influence. What improvements were made, or what steps backwards did they take? I have messed around with this game already a fair bit, but for the playthrough I did for this review, I ended up inviting my friend Ian, who you may remember from my Sengoku Jidai series episode 11, which focused on the arrival of Europeans in Japan.
Hello YouTube, glad to be back.
Ian and I worked together on this playthrough and will both be sharing our thoughts and opinions on the game, as we also both have experience with other entries into the series. So this review will be a little bit less formal and won't cover every single minor aspect, but we still want to give our take on the game. On paper, this game is your typical Nobunaga's Ambition game. Choose from a whole plethora of clans across Japan and try to conquer the country during the chaotic period of warring states known as the Sengoku Jidai. And just like other Nobunaga's Ambition titles, these games are very focused on the history of the period. The more cinematic historical moments also make a return in the actual game, going through the major beats of the period. However, just like in my last review, if you want a more historical playthrough, I recommend not starting at an earlier start date, as the game will quickly go off the rails historically. For this playthrough, we originally played as the Ochi, yet later gave power over to Nabeshima Naoshige, changing our clan over to the Nabeshima clan. It definitely was a bit of an easier start because of the size of the Ochi at the beginning of the game, but we still ran into our fair share of difficulties starting between the Otomo and Amago. But getting more into the actual game itself now, it is the things that Taishi does differently than its predecessors that start to make it more unique. Now, a forum post I saw talking about the game did a great job at summarizing my thoughts regarding it. Basically, for every new entry into the series, for every step forward, there is also a step backwards. But what do I mean by that? Well, a lot of the core features in Taishi are things that have been expanded upon from Sphere of Influence, along with some new additions as well. The problems that we run into are the changes any good? For a lot of them, I would actually say, yeah, there is a fair bit of stuff that actually comes across as an improvement. But right away, we also need to address that this game functions a fair bit differently than Sphere of Influence, and there is a definite steeper learning curve to it. Yet the game also tries its hardest to give you a million tutorials so that you can figure out what you are doing right off the bat. But with that said, let's get into the actual game and first start off with something that the game does right. The game at large feels more engaging. Clans reach out to you more, characters have identities, motivations, and goals, things that all come into play as you try your hardest to conquer the land. This, in my opinion, makes the game feel a bit more alive than Sphere of Influence does in terms of your actual relationships with fellow daimyo. Even with Taishi lacking the interesting quest system that Sphere of Influence had.
This also factors into the diplomacy mechanic, which as a whole is very similar to Sphere of Influence, but also is just a little more expanded upon. Even with Sphere of Influence's awesome influence system, a system obviously absent in Taishi. But while diplomacy feels enriched overall, clan management and politics feel like they've been stripped down a little and are very much lackluster as a result.
The political atmosphere and Sphere of Influence was an important mechanic, as your worldviews came to impact your overall clan decisions as a whole so much more, not only in regards to buildings you constructed, but also in regards to officer management and enacting policies. In both games, policies act as advancements for your clan. The difference comes in regards to how they function. In Sphere of Influence, policies were large-scale decisions dictated by your clan's worldviews. Laws that added both advantages and drawbacks. Choosing them meant putting a level of thought into them, making you think, why do you want to enact a certain policy? These also had a major impact, as enacting one that not all of your officers agreed with may cause anger and resentment amongst those who you employ.
Taishi does away with that system entirely, giving way to a more skill tree-based system that grows throughout the game. As more officers offer up new ideas to make your clan more efficient, these policies do not have any drawbacks and only work to your clan's benefit.
While some people may really like this approach, I personally feel like it robs the player of an aspect of hard decision making that helped make Sphere of Influence unique from a political standpoint. Although, another area that Taishi actually improved upon was trade. If you saw my Sphere of Influence review, one aspect I actually did feel that game was lacking on was an overall trade mechanic, something that Taishi vastly rectified.
In Taishi, the game adds a whole network of trading hubs for you to invest in and monopolize as your own. This all works to grow your wealth and income. Over time, they also evolve and amass into major trading hubs, generating even more wealth for your clan. This system is an incredibly welcome addition to the game, as it creates a new level of strategy and thought process, as you will need to open more trade between other clans in order to gain and monopolize certain trade nodes within your area. In addition to the new trade mechanics, Taishi also offers a new territory management system, a feature which allows you to decide which facilities are built across your provinces. Buildings that add improvements which help with wealth, income, natural disaster prevention, and warfare. While all of this is great on a small scale, as time continues, it becomes a little more tedious to micromanage as your clan grows.
Personally, I much prefer the development system present in Sphere of Influence, which saw you build up your castles, towns, and road networks, each of which completely absent in Taishi. Taishi also adds a new system for agriculture management, where you actually delegate work to your farmers each season. However, this system, in my opinion, doesn't do much to enrich your experience, and rather just feels like an alternative, simple method to do something that was already simple in past games. But how is the warfare? What does Taishi do to improve upon the already stable combat systems in Sphere of Influence? Well, they expanded the features, but perhaps not for the better. What I feel it comes down to is personal preference. Recruiting armies is made different now through the ordering of conscription of farmers and refugees, which act as your militia and infantry. This, I feel, is actually a pretty solid improvement to the generic conscription system you had in Sphere of Influence.
Also, the new marching management system is another welcome addition to the game. In this system, it allows you to greater customize the composition of your armies, selecting which forces march from which castles, who is in charge of the entire army, and how much supplies in terms of guns and horses you bring to a battle. While this in itself is great, we find that the actual movement of armies is a little broken and a little janky.
Where Sphere of Influence had the really interesting road mechanic you could use to strategize your marches, Taishi takes that all away to instead create a system where you simply fly through your own territory, then slow down to a snail's pace in enemy territory. This then leads to the enemy force always being able to outflank you, no matter what you are doing. They will always be able to beat you to where you are going, unless you of course are able to bring multiple armies to distract the enemy force. Then, of course, we get into the actual battles, which, honestly, I have been teetering back and forth with. Are they good? Are they bad? Are they good? Are they bad? And unfortunately, by the end of our campaign for this review, I think I ended on bad.
The battle system in this game works on a turn-by-turn basis. At the beginning of the battle, you decide on a plan suggested to you by your generals, then try your best to execute it. Turn-by-turn, you go back and forth, moving your armies, using special abilities, and pummeling the enemy until eventually somebody wins. So at face value, this sounds like a really great system, and it can actually be a lot of fun, because even the AI is good at commanding its own armies in a pretty strategic way. But what ends up breaking this whole thing is the morale mechanic. So at the top of the screen, you'll notice a morale bar or a balance of power meter, whichever you want to call it. Over the course of the battle, this swings back and forth depending on how the battle's going and who's doing more pummeling.
This works fine sometimes, but other times completely screws you over. We had battles that we lost due to this balance of power meter swinging out of our favor when we were completely on top of things and routing the enemy. This actually happened a lot. A large amount of the time, we even had like 3 times the amount of the enemy's numbers, and were winning, yet still lost due to the meter. In fact, going into battle commanding a much larger amount of soldiers will in most cases not even guarantee you victory, simply due to the potential narrowness of the battlefield.
So what gets even worse is when you factor in defender outposts. These are stations that attackers will need to destroy as they constantly cause your morale to drop and swing the battle in the favor of the defender. Eventually, what we discovered is that simply blobbing all of your units into a mass began to prove more effective than actually sticking to the battle plan suggested to you by your generals. This really sucked because it took all of the strategic decision making out of the equation entirely.
On the other hand, Sphere of Influence's system was way more bare bones, but it was also somewhat more fair. If you lost a battle, you definitely knew why, and was largely due to factors you could better control. On the warfare front, I definitely prefer the simplicity of Sphere of Influence over the complexity and confusing nature present in Taishi, which sucks because I actually feel the combat system was just a hair away from being really, really good. The final thing we want to touch on is the late game, which, we're not gonna lie, in our opinion, Taishi's late game is not that good. The larger your clan gets, the more it becomes a chore to manage, which then causes you to go and delegate all of your tasks to let the AI handle it.
Which is kind of funny because the AI handles things much better than the player could, unless you are really, really nitpicky about your micromanaging. Then in that case, you might have a blast with doing something like that on that kind of a scale.
The same gameplay style was actually also present in Sphere of Influence as well. The difference comes in regards to how it works. In Sphere of Influence, you actually created provinces, then placed regions in charge of governing swaths of your territory. This all worked better to make you feel like you were still in charge and doing something useful, putting your best and most loyal commanders in charge of important duties. They even went to war for you and helped expand your domain. On top of that, your custom provinces could all be further managed and tweaked, as you decided how they would function. This is a feature completely missing from Taishi, as the system in Taishi just has you check a box to let the AI handle everything.
Winning the game also feels much more hollow, as a certain amount of time passes after you take Kyoto, you just automatically become Shogun. Then after taking a majority of the province capitals, you will randomly get a prompt to lay down the war ban and win the game if you so choose. Sphere of Influence actually had you complete a quest to become Shogun. Once you were, you actually gained a whole nother set of political decisions you could make as the Shogun. Where did that all go? Why did they choose to make victory feel so much lesser? But after you beat the campaign at least once, it unlocks another fictional campaign that places all of the famous daimyo on the map at the same time. Which could definitely make for a pretty awesome clown fiesta.
Alright, to summarize our thoughts though, I feel Taishi makes a number of interesting additions and improvements that overall create a new game that can still prove to be pretty fun. Yet, I also still believe that Sphere of Influence is the superior game, and far more well-rounded experience. If I was to talk to someone who had never played this series before, but was interested in it, I would immediately recommend Sphere of Influence over Taishi, as it is also a far more friendly title for new players.
I would also definitely recommend Sphere of Influence to new players, as the general gameplay flow is a little easier for somebody to understand. In Taishi, it does this, you know, there's a lot to it, but that's not to say that the game doesn't do a pretty decent job of explaining everything through lots of tutorials, provided you are patient enough to actually read through them to understand all the game functions. So one of the big picture points that, for me personally, I found in reviewing this is that when you compare it to Sphere of Influence, it's sort of comparing an apple to a pear in the sense that they're similar but not quite the same. I mean, there are features in both that, you know, both of us really, really enjoy, but then also wish that certain features crossed over into other games, and it just... For somebody who hasn't played either, it's sort of whatever you prefer. And you know, if you like the bigger overarching clan-based type grand strategies, I would maybe consider Taishi. But if you like things that are a little more intimate and feel a little more personal, maybe Sphere of Influence is the way to go.
There is a lot more we could get into regarding minor features like Imperial Court politics, the new council phase system, and the new UI, but what we talked about here is pretty much all the big things. In terms of an actual rating, both Ian and I agree that this game is a fairly solid 7 out of 10. It has a lot of potential for a good time, but will also leave a bit to be desired. While certain aspects were improved, others were removed or made lesser. If you like the series, I will say it is definitely a game you should check out. Anyways, have you played Nobunaga's Ambition Taishi? If you have, let us know what you think in the comments below, or if we didn't talk about a feature in the game that you think is important to mention.
But as always, thank you for watching, and don't forget to like and subscribe, and ring that notification bell if you enjoyed this video and found it to be most interesting.